for me, the excitement is often finding that sound, finding that instrument that connects with that character in some way or that story, you know. But it's not a visual thing. It's an idea, you know. I make that connection in my head, and it's often, and when it's exciting, it's not what you would necessarily think would work. You know, it's not an obvious, you know, instrument from the period or in the film itself, but it's something a little bit left field, and that really excites me, and it somehow feels right, but you'd never guess it.
People are just absolutely stunned by what's happening around them.
We did quite a big shift when I came on board, and definitely for me that was part of the incentive, was the filmmakers seemed open to the idea of changing the way of using music. In the previous scenes, the music had been fantastic, really beautifully produced, but it was very lush and rich and full, and quite a lot of it. And we really tried to make a decision to focus in on the emotion of certain characters, find themes and ideas that would resonate with them, and cut down the use of music and use it in a very particular moment. When a music cue comes in, it really counts, rather than it being a sort of comfort blanket.
Take care.
You too.
But just the very simple harp, which is just a harp arpeggio. It had a purpose, and also it, then the sort of big weighty chords come in over it. Often people say to me, oh, there's quite a lot of music in The Crown. And actually isn't. There's not very many. Often we will only write 4, 5, 6 cues for an episode. But I hope that you really notice them when they're there, so you kind of are aware of it. And that was what we were really trying to achieve.
If you could follow the example of your great-grandmother, love and happiness will surely follow.
About throwing the kitchen sink at it and being bigger and bolder and brassier than anybody else. It's about using sort of quite familiar elements, but using them in an interesting way and a restrained way. And as I say, making us lean in and really, really pay attention to the music. And Peter Morgan, the showrunner, was always saying, you know, no, it's too much. It's too much. You know, let's do it with less. Let's cut back the music here and never wanting to use music as sort of traditional score. You know, whenever it sounded like normal score, he was always, no, just that's not right.
But in light of the events of the last 12 months, perhaps I have more to reflect on than most. 1992 is not a year on which I shall look back with undiluted pleasure. It has turned out to be an annus horribilis.
The creative process on The Crown is really unlike any other show I've worked on. Usually with a program, they film it, they edited it, I will get a rough cut and off we go, and we're writing music, and I'll be writing music with other people's music in there as temp track, but there was none of that. I started writing music as soon as they started filming. I read the scripts and then responded to that. And after just conversations with Peter Morgan, the showrunner, you know, I'd write him an album's worth. And then often it would just go away, really. It just went into the edit and they messed around with it. And then it comes back to me almost as a fully formed episode with all my music in it. And that's a really very rewarding, very organic, really good way to get into the heart of a piece from early on. It's not like it's stuck on at the end. It really grows with as the episode develops.
As husband and wife live out their vows, loving and cherishing one another, sharing life's splendors and miseries, achievements and setbacks, they will be transformed in the process. Our faith sees the wedding day not as the place of arrival, but the place where the adventure really begins.
The discovery of the solo French horn, I think, for its lover horn, was a particular moment.
Yes, ma'am.
I need to speak to the Queen.
The breakthrough for me probably was on season 3. We were really struggling with this amazing scene where the Queen walks around Aberfan, which was a coal mining disaster where loads of kids died in Wales in the 60s. And she's walking around this site, looking at all the devastation, and is struggling herself to feel emotion about it. And so I had the really complicated thing of writing a piece of music to try and make our audience feel emotional about a woman who couldn't feel emotion. The solo French horn signified the sense of duty, the sense of the weight of office that this woman felt. And that worked really beautifully. That got picked up throughout the series and comes back again and again. And it's very much her. She's got her queen's hat on and she is, you know, she's feeling the weight of that crown. People seem to need and want this institution and these characters. And certainly if you, you know, put it to a poll about getting rid of the royal family, it would never happen. And so I think it's trying to understand why people want this and what this role of these people are, what the duty that falls upon them is. And I think that's the main purpose of it. That's what we understand from it. Even though I was sort of nervous about taking on something that was already established and someone else's, you know, it being in the shadow of Hans Zimmer and Rupert Grayson Williams, it was still, you know, you can't really turn that down, the crown. So good.